everyone, welcome to another Species Spotlight. Kelsey here at the Key West Tropical Forest and Botanical Garden. This week we are in our historic butterfly garden, highlighting our erect prickly pear cactus. This is a native species to the Florida Keys. They can be found from South Carolina south through Florida in coastal areas, along the Gulf Coast through Texas into Mexico, Central America, and down into northern South America. They are endemic to these areas, the word endemic meaning that they are restricted to a small particular area. And they're also introduced in other parts of the world. So they can be found in Asia, in Australia, and in Africa. In some of those places, they are naturalized, which means that they are not harmful to the environment and they're well adapted to grow in the introduced area. However, in other places where they've been introduced, they're considered to be invasive. So what invasive means is that they spread very quickly and that they cause harm to the environment. So they can cause harm because these guys can grow up to 6.5 feet tall. They can get really, really wide, and they can cover an entire area and essentially prevent any animals from moving into that area at all because of these super spiky spines that they have all over them. In Australia, they've done something pretty interesting to control the invasive population. They have released a species of moth that preys on the prickly pear cactus, and it's done a good job at controlling this invasive species. However, the same moth was introduced to Texas in 2017 and wreaked havoc on the prickly pear, who was native in that area, so it was harmful to the environment there. Now, these guys are easily identifiable. They are, of course, in the prickly pear family. There are many species of prickly pear cactus. This is specifically the erect prickly pear cactus. And they have these green fleshy pads that grow one on top of the other, like you can see here. As they age, they become brown and more calloused, like the ones on the bottom. They look more like a tree trunk. And newer growth is this really nice bright green. On the pads, you'll see areas where the spines grow out of. So they'll grow in clusters of yellow spines between one and about three or four spines in each cluster. On newer growth, you'll see a different kind of spine. So like on this fruit right here, we see these tiny little spiky yellow spines. Those are called glockids. And spines are really interesting. So clearly, the first thing you think of why would a cactus have a spine is for protection. So spines deter predators. Something like maybe an iguana would be less inclined to take a bite out of this cactus because of all these spiky spines that it's covered in. However, they also help to conserve and to collect water for the cactus. Where do cactuses usually grow? In places that there aren't a lot of water, like deserts. Here we have a wet season and we have a dry season. So in order for them to survive through the dry season, they still need water. So these spines will restrict airflow right close to the pads. The pads are really fleshy and store a lot of water for the plant. Less airflow around the pads means less transpiration or evaporation of water from the plant. So basically that means that the spines make it so less water leaves the plant, more water stays inside of the pads. The spines can also collect dew in a foggy or humid environment. Down here in the Florida Keys, we know that it's super humid, and so the spines are able to collect moisture from the air, which can help collect more water for the cactus. Now you'll also notice that on the top, you'll see these purple to pink to reddish looking fruits. They're almost the size, a little bit smaller than maybe the size of an egg. And that's where their seeds are stored. So in each one of these fruits, there are between 60 and 180 seeds. That's a lot of seeds. Now their seeds are spread by animals who eat them and then spread them later. So those can be birds or mammals. They're also edible to humans. And I've seen them in salsas or even in salads, and they're really delicious. So they can be spread by their seeds. They can also be spread by cuttings. So each one of these pads can be cut off at its callus. For example, I believe there's a few sitting on the rock over here that have been cut off. If those were to be planted in the ground, they could possibly root and create a clone of the parent plant. So those are two ways in which this plant can be spread. Another way that this plant reproduces is through its flowers. So here's a really good example of their yellow flowers. They bloom singly, so there's one flower on each pad. They can be pollinated by moths, beetles, bees, butterflies, a wide range of pollinators. And you can tell that this is specifically an erect prickly pear by looking. One of the ways that you can tell is by looking at the flower, looking at the inside, and you'll notice that everything is yellow. In some prickly pear species, the insides of the flowers will actually be red, so they're a little bit different. And one last interesting fact. So cactuses around the world, every one in three species of cactus are endangered. So that means that their population is declining, or there's not many of them left, and they are at risk of going extinct. However, this prickly pear cactus is considered least concern, meaning they're not endangered at all. They're doing just fine. So I hope you guys learned a lot this week, and I hope to see you next week.